Welcome to City Cinematheque, where the art and pleasure of the movies are the subject of serious discussion. I'm your host, Jerry Carlson, and I teach film studies at the City College of the City University of New York. Today, it's our pleasure to start celebrating the 25th anniversary of a film that's important both to American independent film and to women's filmmaking in the United States. It's Tell Me a Riddle, based upon the novella by Tilly Olson and directed by Lee Grant. This is a story of an elderly couple coming to terms with their lives and with their marriage as they voyage, episodically, from one member of the family to another. It's really a very beautiful work and a key work in a lot of ways for what will come in the American independent cinema. It's our pleasure to have here as two guests after the screening, one of the producers, Rachel Lyon, and the director herself, Lee Grant, the Academy Award-winning actress. Now, take this opportunity to voyage into Tell Me a Riddle. Welcome back to City Cinematheque. I hope you've enjoyed this occasion to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the release of Tell Me a Riddle. As I mentioned in the introduction, a key film in women's filmmaking in the United States, as well as a key film in independent American filmmaking. It's a pleasure to have 30 minutes to talk about that and some other things with two of the creators of the work. First, I'd like to present my colleague from CUNY, now teaching at Queens College, Professor Rachel Lyon, who is one of the producers of the film. Rachel is an award-winning producer, and she's made three feature films, over 60 documentaries, and she's working on a documentary now about race and the death penalty in the United States. Welcome to City Cinematheque, Rachel.
Thank you.
Right. And next to Rachel is the film's director, Lee Grant, known to many people, I think, as the Academy Award-winning actress, but also not as many people, I think, know about your extensive career as a director, including an Academy Award for a documentary film, as well as fiction directing. You've done over 70, you're telling me, intimate portraits for a lifetime, as well as, it seems to me, almost countless documentaries for others, including an upcoming HBO documentary you've recently been producing on medics in Iraq. Congratulations to both of you for having docs coming out this year. We think that's, 25 years later, and to know.
Yay!
So we'll get to the present eventually in the next 30 minutes.
Right.
But let's start with the past. Lee, how did this come to be your first feature film project? The selection of the book, how did that come about?
Well, you know, that's really a question for Rachel, because she was a little girl then, just out of college, and from the lore, Rachel told me that Tilly Olson came to the college and read As I Stand Ironing, or one of those great short stories of hers, and she and three other friends who became the godmothers, who put this project together as little girls do because they don't know that they can't,
right,
and that it's an impossible task. They put it together, and you know, Rachel can tell you more about it. And she'd seen the first film that I ever did in my life at the American Film Institute. Half-hour film of Strindberg's The Stronger.
Right.
And so they decided to take a chance on me, who, you know, had never done anything except, you know, at the American Film Institute. And they came to me with this project, and it was superb.
Okay.
It was a superb project. It was everything that I could ever dream of in my life. But you know, but Rachel talked about.
Let's go. Let's cut to Rachel
as action.
So. But let's do the origin of this project. But also this whole notion that the making an independent film 25 years ago was different than it is now. So how did you just decide you're going to make a movie of this? How did that end up happening?
Well, it is true that Tilly Olson came to the college that a couple of us went to Washington University and read, and you know, sort of 60 of us, or actually about 600 of us, were in tears and all of that, and we decided to go and ask her if we could make the book. She had turned down four major filmmakers. She was afraid they were going to damage the book.
Okay.
And because the thing that you have to do in getting a hold of a book is have the right to destroy it. You hope you don't, but you have to have that right in order to reinterpret it. And Tilly decided to trust us, and we initially got fooled. We did well in the first stage of raising some development mm-hmm. money, and we kind of got things together, got an initial script together, et cetera. And we went to every single filmmaker that we loved and asked them how they got their first film made, because there were no, there were like no women. I mean, there was like, Ida Lupino, and Mary Pickford. I mean, we really didn't have a lot to go on at that point. They all met with us. Francis Coppola met with us. Martin Scorsese met with us. They all said different things. Martin Scorsese said, you know, lie, steal, cheat, shoot, shoot, shoot. You know, Francis said one thing. Everybody said something else. But they all said, do it. They all said, do it. And the key thing about Tell Me a Riddle was that the actors, we knew we were going to get great actors because there are no parts for people in their 70s. So we were going to have to work with a director, probably a first-time director, who could command the work, if you will, of someone like Melvin Douglas.
Right.
And that was one of the big reasons why we felt Lee would be able to do that. While it was her first time directing, she was so experienced, not just in acting, but also directing in and around, the Actors Studio and some of the other places.
Right.
So it just seemed like a natural fit. Also, this was a radical book. It really is.
Yeah.
And we needed someone who was at the very least progressive and willing to take a risk on that front. So our whole group, everybody was on the blacklist. Lee had been blacklisted. Melvin Douglas had been blacklisted. I felt like we got a major course in the world of blacklisting American artists by doing this film.
If you'll excuse what may seem to be a slightly frivolous phrasing, it's a certain kind of comeback film for a lot of people in the sense, not in the sense that they weren't doing well and all that, but the particular group of people that was pulled together for this, you know, to do a very distinguished piece of literature that has a very specific social perspective and tells a very specific kind of historical vision. Well, you know, 20 years earlier, all these folks weren't being able to do anything. And now they could come together, form a team, and get this kind of vision of American history and of American immigrant life onto the screen. And I must say, as I was going by, I hadn't thought, when I first saw the film, I hadn't thought of everybody's background. But it's an absolutely fascinating, you know, not only is the film distinguished, but the fact that all these people could come together to make it at this particular moment. Okay, so let's talk about how you ended up choosing the Melvin Douglas and Lila Pedrova. Kudrova. I knew that. How did the casting work for the film?
Well, Lee really did a lot of the major casting. I mean, there was a great group of people available, but in terms of particularly Melvin, I mean, I think that was a real stroke of genius, frankly, on your part, because he gave maybe his very best performance, his last performance, his very best.
Well, Melvin, he did the picture with Hal Ashby.
Being there,
and he was so remarkable in it, and he'd been, you know, doing like other character parts.
In The Candidate, for example.
He was
marvelous.
Brilliant in The Candidate.
Yeah.
And I knew that he had had a background, certainly. His wife was forced out of running for office by Nixon. I had been a blacklisted actor. And I had a lot that I wanted to bring to it of my own experiences, and we mustn't forget that Joyce Eliason was the one who wrote the screenplay with me, and so it put a whole different spin.
Tell people about the other the screenwriter.
Joyce Eliason is a very, very successful screenwriter in California today, And we met at that time when she was like really starting to be in demand. And she was brilliantly talented, and somehow from her own experience, which had nothing to do with politics, absolutely nothing to do with politics, she found her way into this in a very, because these characters, as those of those of you who have seen it, are very fleshed out.
Right,
they're very found, and we almost had an improvisational a move in terms of this woman, this what's her name in the film? The one that Leela played,
Eva.
Eva had been a part of the kind of glory of the revolution. She had been a part of the moving of Russia into the Soviet Union, where they were moving from really slaves, from their being emperors and slaves, moving into a place that was hopeful of a democracy.
Right.
And so she had been a leading, passionate young girl who was leading whole movements there. And the last thing that she says, of course, to her granddaughter is, "These are my heroes."
Right.
And they were all people who had been imprisoned, who had been jailed, who had been, I start choking up when I think of it, the Akhmatovas, you know, and the Gorkys and the writers who were our heroes.
Right.
And who were like absolutely politically out as far as Stalin and Stalinism was concerned. So there was that great kind of turn where those of the people who I was connected to in here, when I first started fighting the blacklist,
right,
when those were people who said, "But the Soviet Union is, you know, that's, they're fighting for the little people, they're fighting against capitalism." You know, and then the story came out of all the artists who were killed, who were put away, who were silenced, I must say, in the same way that I feel Putin is doing today, just to add, you know, an up-to-date.
No, it's an ongoing, the tension between political structures and power and artistic expression and freedom is an ongoing struggle globally. Just because the Soviet Union is officially a non-communist state doesn't mean it doesn't have characteristics of an authoritarian state that will threaten artists or journalists or whoever steps
absolutely
in their path.
Absolutely. I mean, the journalists now. There is no journalist who can criticize the government at this
right
point. I mean, that's out now. So the wheel has turned. But the opportunity that we had, that Rachel had, and that I had, to explore that time, that time of idealism for her, that time of idealism for me, the punishment that I had as an actor for wanting to fight for people, to be communists or not be communists, or be of the left or not of the left at a time, and not have to lose their jobs and suffer for it, was something that was permitted for me in this film. And of course, I would never get an opportunity like that again. It was seminal in my life.
Well, and so beautifully realized, I have to say, because one of the lines of the many I like so much in the script is the little scene which is talking about the potential embarrassment over the mother's accent. That whole notion,
yes,
that something foreign, even that you can't lose, you can't speak like an American in a place like Nebraska,
yeah,
brands you in when we go through our cycles of xenophobia, it brands you in a certain way. But then the film, I wanted to ask you about the script and the structure of her visions of her own past, the way in which she has all the flashbacks, some of them extended, some others of them genuinely close to flash cuts. In all kinds of ways. Was that an original part of the concept of the script? Because it's beautifully realized.
Was it?
The flashbacks occur in the original book,
yes,
in the novella. Much of of Eva's story is revealed both in sort of this internal monologue, which was one of Joyce Eliason's brilliant efforts as a screenwriter, was bringing that internal monologue into dialogue and into to action. Along with Lee, but the other important aspect was working with these flashbacks. And I have heard, I mean, the flashbacks are taught in film history classes because they work in a similar way to The Pawnbroker, for example, there's a visual stimulus often that brings her to the past, not always, but often, and or an audio, something that she hears, something that she sees or something that she hears that brings her to the past. And we become more aware of her, if you will, greatness by understanding the downturns that happened over the course of her life, the times when being a woman and a mom became oppressive for her.
Right. But also since Eva, by the time we come to her, has her hearing aid on, and whenever she doesn't want to participate in life, she switches it off so that Eva doesn't talk. Eva is outside. Eva has retreated into her inner life. So if we didn't have those flashbacks in film,
there would
be no entrance into her life.
Well, thank you for illustrating one of the points that when I teach, I sometimes break up, say to my students, I said, there really aren't any rules except the rules of what the story and the characters demand. So if somebody tells you you should never use narration, what's the story? Should you be using narration in this story? No, flashbacks are bad. For what story or what? And I think you've given this marvelous explanation of why exactly this beautifully rendered technique is appropriate for this character and getting, as we were talking a little bit earlier, getting so much a depth. Because so many of the characters we see are done maybe in a brilliant two or three strokes, but there's not anything behind that. And now that can, itself can be intriguing, but we really get to know these characters. Now, what was it like directing the two principals? I mean, how did they?
Like butter.
Well, that's what you get for working with professionals.
No, I've worked with a lot of professionals, but first of all, I think Lila Kadrova is a genius. You know, I thought she was in Zorba, the Greek, and I thought, oh my God, how fortunate we are. I remember my first choice was Elizabeth Bergner. I don't know whether you remember her, because she was a remarkable childish German actress who had a certain vogue here, I think, in the 30s or 40s.
Right, that's the 30s, you know, I'm thinking.
And I called her and I'd sent her the script, and she said, it's too close to me, darling. It's too close, and I'm too close to the end. Well, Lila was in her 60s.
Yeah.
In her 60s, and she was a soubrette. She was a flirt. She was, you know, all the things she does with her hands and with her shoulders, you know, and so what she wanted me to do was to change it to the Second World War, so that she could play it
younger
than she was. No, Eva. It's the same war. It's the Russian Revolution. It's not the Second World War.
Can't change the war for you, right?
But the things that she found in pulling back and excluding herself, you know, the things that she did with her body and her hands, that, you know, were so exquisite. And the only direction I really had to give her was not to wear mascara. She tried to sneak in the mascara all the time, and I used to turn to the makeup lady and say, why are you putting mascara on her? You know, because she tried to hide it, she'd do it secretly, and of course the makeup lady knew that I was teasing her. I'm sorry. But Lila just, found it in that great organic way that you don't know. That's a mystery when people are that gifted. Melvin was, you know, had that kind of child insecurity. He was so open about it. You know, I don't move well. I've got arthritis in my thing. I can't move well. I've never done an accent before. I don't know whether I can. I don't know whether I'll be good enough. And so he had that wonderful laying out of his insecurities.
Right.
Of course you can do it. And he said, they're going to hate me for being so mean to her. And it's like, it happens every single time when we screen this. When he gets up on the ladder to try and fix the roof.
Oh, yes.
And he gets up to a point and he looks up. When he looks up, the whole audience goes, oh, he can't make it.
Right.
He can't make it anymore. And I said, when they see you can't make it anymore, everybody will be on your side.
Yeah. And they are. It's a wonderful scene because the you know, again, the film has so many of these signature visual moments like that in which we see these characters in a particular environment. And that, I mean, again, I'm thinking of something like going to the long-lost friend's apartment in San Francisco and being able to sort of assemble what her life is like.
Ugh. Mm-hmm. And what an actress.
She did a really marvelous job. But, you know, going back to Melvin for a minute, he was very concerned about the challenges he had in being mobile. And he was also, I have to say, we had to separately insure 17 parts of his body. It was like amazing. I had never seen
what?
Separately insure 17 parts of his body. So his
better person, you didn't.
Yeah, his personal body was more expensive than our film stock. You know? But he, when we met him, when the Godmothers met him, he met us in a Connecticut restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
And he had us seated before he got there. And then once we were seated, we were in view of a staircase going up to the restrooms were upstairs. And he just walked down the stairs. He didn't discuss how he was. He just wanted us to see how hard it was for him to walk down the stairs. If we still wanted him, he wanted the part. I mean, he didn't want to discuss it on the phone. He didn't want his agent to talk about it with us. He wanted us to come and see how hard it would be. And in the scene where they tussle over the suitcase.
I was just thinking
and
about
he's
that.
Supposed to be the stronger one. Here's Leela, you know, 15 years younger than she's married to a guy 30 something years younger than she is. She's married to a guy half
in
her
life.
Age. Right, in real life. And he's supposed to win the fight. And so Lee, which, you know, you should probably take over, but had to direct this in such a way that he appears the stronger one who can grab the suitcase.
But she does grab it from him, and she really hurt his hand. I love this, that little section where he goes, oh, don't worry. Where she hurts his finger, she pulls the thing from him, and he staggers back. And of course, that's
absolutely
real.
Absolutely. Now, one of the other things about his performance I think is worth noting is of course, that you directed both of them with the accent. And, you know, I always thought of Melvin Douglas as just a wonderful actor from his ingenue male kinds of roles all the way through this later. But when you think of him in The Candidate or you think of him being there, he's so quintessentially American. And here in one of his last... And urbane. And here in his last role, he's a working class immigrant. And you utterly believe in him as such. Did he eventually get comfortable with working in the accent?
Totally. Oh, absolutely. Oh, absolutely. I don't know how long we had to rehearse.
A couple of weeks we had with him.
Yeah, and so by the time, you know, we went into like a, you know, the next phase of rehearsal, he had found it, he was comfortable in it, and he loved it, yeah.
Well, now, I think it's for the 25th anniversary, it's worth talking about what happened when the film came out. How much difficulty did you have finding a distributor, and then what was the original reception like?
Well, it's a It's a very interesting story. I mean, I think every film is. First of all, we went to 5,000 individuals to get 35 to say yes to funding the film. I mean, we were begging for years to get this film funded. And Lee luckily waited for us for years as we...
Well, I became a documentary maker while I was waiting. It was
Well, so that worked out for you.
Oh, no, it really, really did. I made my first documentary while I was waiting for them, and that, you know, opened up such another door in my life.
Oh, that's great. We've only got about 2 minutes left for the whole thing, so I'm going to have you just sort of cut to the chase on this one.
So we were the first film directed by a woman to open at the Cannes New Directors Fortnight. We played all over the country to fantastic reviews. We didn't do that well financially, but we did, you know, get major distribution from United Artists, and we did get help on that from Saul Zanson Fantasy Films. They became our executive producer, which was another whole story, but they did a good job with that. And in fact, Saul hired our production designer, Patrizia von Brandenstein, to do his next film, which at that point was Amadeus, for which she won an Academy Award.
Okay, I'm gonna have to just call it a halt right now. If you would like more information about City Cinematheque, or more generally about CUNY TV, it will be no surprise that the best way to get that information is to visit our website. That's www.cuny.tv. Once again, www.cuny.tv. Rachel, Lee, 30 minutes could hardly go faster.
I know.
it's really quite remarkable. There's a lot of other things to discuss. We'll have to save it for another day. I'd like to remind everybody that the film is now going to be out and it's just a super version on DVD, so people have an opportunity to enjoy the pleasures of this film again. Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you. Well, we're so grateful to talk about it.
Super. And thank you for joining us today, and I hope you join us again as we stroll through the archives of film history on City Cinematheque. Bye for now.